I've dedicated myself to the care and study of people with connective tissue disorders. Connective tissue is the material between the cells of the body that give the tissues form and strength. In some people, that connective tissue is formed abnormally, and that can lead to many serious health problems. In Marfan syndrome, we knew when to do surgery, we knew what kind of imaging to perform, and in that way, we knew how to take really good care of those folks. The separate group of people, when we tried to apply the same rules, were not doing so well. They were having tears of their blood vessels when we didn't expect it. They weren't responding as well to medications. So we became dedicated to try to better define this group in order to better serve these people. It turned out that these people have a different connective tissue disorder that is related to Marfan syndrome. It's caused by mutations in a cellular pathway that we call the TGF-beta pathway. And we've now been able to show that changes or mutations in at least 6 different genes that encode proteins that drive the TGF-beta pathway can cause Loeys-Dietz syndrome. The presentations, the problems of Loeys-Dietz syndrome can be very evident in early infancy, but in other people can show up later in life. Folks with Loeys-Dietz syndrome have many problems throughout the body. It can involve the craniofacial system, things such as cleft palate, for example. Commonly involves the skeleton with overgrowth of the bones and also laxity of the joints. But most importantly, it involves the blood vessels of the body. The arteries become prone to enlargement, and if left untreated, put someone at risk for sudden tear of a major blood vessel that can lead to sudden death. We now know that we need to image all of the blood vessels throughout the body from head to toe, not just focusing on the base of the aorta as we would in Marfan syndrome. We know that certain medications that lower blood pressure and alter cellular behavior show promise for the treatment of Loeys-Dietz syndrome. We know when to refer to our surgical colleagues. We've learned that these patients respond beautifully to surgery as long as the problems are detected early. Our hope is to be able to prevent problems rather than to have to react to problems with surgery. We've gone on to make mouse models of Loeys-Dietz syndrome by introducing mutations that we had first observed in people into the corresponding mouse gene. These mouse models show all of the features of Loeys-Dietz syndrome. Using the mice, we've been able to better define the sequence of events that leads to tissue problems, to tissue failure. And we have been able to come up with very effective medical strategies that can blunt or even prevent problems that we see in Loeys-Dietz syndrome in mouse models. Now the challenge is to determine how those treatment strategies can best be applied to people. We want to be able to rigorously test new medications that we believe will be helpful for people with Loeys-Dietz syndrome. We're trying to find the Achilles heel, find the weak spot in all these molecular links where we can best help someone with Loeys-Dietz syndrome. So we're very fortunate to have many different people in different disciplines who have now dedicated a large part of their career to try to help people with Loeys-Dietz syndrome. Funding that we recently received from the KASPER family is allowing us to increase that team. It's allowing us to create a patient registry so we can do our best, generate rules that are specific to the individual sitting across from us. We have the privilege of caring for about 600 families with Loeys-Dietz syndrome at Johns Hopkins. We've trained many of the individuals who are now at other institutions doing excellent work to care for these people. So we've really become a hub of knowledge regarding proper patient care, but also a focus for research that we're now disseminating throughout the country and throughout the world. We've made a lot of progress, but there's a lot more work to do.